Another one of my favorite things is a book by Kahlil Gibran, Jesus, the Son of Man. Jesus, the Son of Man. And I remember reading this as a young teenager and being enthralled with what Kahlil Gibran was able to encapsulate within it of Jesus from the viewpoint of many, many different individuals. So I'd like to read from page 93 of this book, Malachi of Babylon, an astronomer. You question me concerning the miracles of Jesus. Every thousand years, the sun and the moon and this earth and all her sister planets meet in a straight line, and they confer for a moment together. Then they slowly disperse and await the passing of another thousand years. There are no miracles beyond the seasons, yet you and I do not know all the seasons. And what if a season shall be made manifest in the shape of a man? In Jesus, the elements of our bodies and our dreams came together according to law. All that was timeless before him became timeful in him. They say he gave sight to the blind and walking to the paralyzed, and that he drove devils out of madmen. Perchance blindness is but a dark thought that can be overcome by a burning thought. Perchance a withered limb is but idleness that can be quickened by energy. And perhaps the devils, these restless elements in our life, are driven out by the angels of peace and serenity. They say he raised the dead to life. If you can tell me what is death, then I will tell you what is life. In a field I have watched an acorn, a thing so still and seemingly useless. And in the spring I have seen that acorn take roots and rise, the beginning of an oak tree, towards the sun. Surely you will deem this a miracle. Yet that miracle is wrought a thousand times in the drowsiness of every autumn and the passion of every spring. Why shall it not be wrought in the heart of man? Shall not the seasons meet in the hand or upon the lips of a man anointed? If our God has given to earth the art to nestle seed whilst the seed is seemingly dead, why shall he not give to the heart of man to breathe life into another heart, even a heart seemingly dead? I have spoken of these miracles, which I deem but little beside the greater miracle, which is the man himself, the wayfarer, the man who turned my dross into gold, who taught me how to love those who hate me, and in so doing brought me comfort and gave sweet dreams to my sleep. This is the miracle of my own life. My soul was blind, my soul was lame, I was possessed by restless spirits, and I was dead. But now I see clearly, and I walk erect. I am at peace, and I live to witness and proclaim my own being every hour of the day. Am I not one of his followers? I am but an old astronomer who visits the fields of space once a season, and who would be heedful of the law and the miracles thereof. And I am at the twilight of my time, but whenever I would seek its dawning, I seek the youth of Jesus. And forever shall age seek youth. In me now, it is knowledge that is seeking vision. Here's a beautiful image within this book. One of the many that Kahlil Gibran painted. And many of you may not know that he was an artist really before he was a writer. And I've been enthralled with all of his writings from an early age, my teenage years, and here's another one in color. Many of the ones in the Prophet, in the books that you've seen, are black and white. Some of these are in color, which is beautiful. And these books and these writings really brought me to a state of inner presence, inner knowingness of who I am. Here is his image of Jesus. Very mystical, very unique. And then another that I really love, another individual. And this could be his representation of Mary Magdalene. I think I'd like to read a section on Mary Magdalene on page 12 of this book. It was in the month of June when I saw him for the first time. He was walking in the wheat field when I passed by with my handmaidens. He was alone. The rhythm of his step was different from other men's, and the movement of his body was like naught I had seen before. Men do not pace the earth in that manner, and even now I do not know whether he walked fast or slow. My handmaidens pointed their fingers at him and spoke in shy whispers to one another. And I stayed my steps for a moment and raised my hand to hail him. But he did not turn his face and did not look at me. And I hated him. I was swept back into myself, and I was as cold as if I had been in a snowdrift, and I shivered. That night I beheld him in my dreaming. They told me afterward that I screamed in my sleep and was restless upon my bed. It was in the month of August that I saw him again through my window. He was sitting in the shadow of the cypress tree across my garden, and he was as still as if he had been carved out of stone, like the statues in Antioch and other cities of the North Country. And my slave, the Egyptian, came to me and said, "That man is here again. He is sitting there across your garden." And I gazed at him, and my soul quivered within me, for he was beautiful. His body was single, and each part seemed to love every other part. Then I clothed myself with raiment of Damascus, and I left my house and walked towards him. Was it my aloneness, or was it his fragrance that drew me to him? Was it a hunger in my eyes that desired comeliness, or was it his beauty that sought the light of my eyes? Even now, I do not know. I walked to him with my scented garments and my golden sandals, the sandals the Roman captain had given me, even these sandals. And when I reached him, I said, "Good morrow to you." And he said, "Good morrow to you, Miriam." And he looked at me, and his night eyes saw me as no man had seen me. And suddenly I was as if naked, and I was shy. Yet he had only said, "Good morrow to you." Then I said to him, "Will you now come to my house?" And he said, "Am I not already in your house?" I did not know what he meant then, but I know now. And I said, "Will you not have wine and bread with me?" And he said, "Yes, Miriam, but not now." "Not now, not now," he said. And the voice of the sea was in those two words, and the voice of the wind in the trees. And when he said them unto me, life spoke to death. Remind you, my friend, I was dead. I was a woman who had divorced her soul. I was living apart from myself, which you now see. I belonged to all men and to none. They called me harlot and a woman possessed of seven devils. I was cursed and I was envied. But when his dawn eyes looked into my eyes, all the stars of my night faded away, and I became Miriam, only Miriam, a woman lost to the earth she had known and finding herself in new places. Now again I said to him, come into my house and share bread and wine with me. And he said, why do you bid me to be your guest? And I said, I beg you to come into my house. And it was all that was sod in me and all that was sky in me calling unto him. Then he looked at me, and the noontide of his eyes was upon me, and he said, you have many lovers, and yet I alone love you. Other men love themselves in your nearness. I love you in yourself. Other men see a beauty in you that shall fade away sooner than their own years. But I see in you a beauty that shall not fade away. And in the autumn of your days, that beauty shall not be afraid to gaze at itself in the mirror, and shall not be offended. I alone love the unseen in you. Then he said in a low voice, go away now. If this cypress tree is yours and you would not have me sit in its shadow, I will walk my way. And I cried to him and I said, Master, come to my house. I have incense to burn for you and a silver basin for your feet. You are a stranger and yet not a stranger. I entreat you, come to my house. And he stood up and looked at me even as the seasons might look down upon the field. And he smiled, and he said again, all men love you for themselves. I love you for yourself. And then he walked away. But no other man ever walked the way he walked. Was it a breath born in my garden that moved to the east? Or was it a storm that would shake all things to their foundations? I knew not. But on that day, the sunset of his eyes slew the dragon in me, and I became a woman. I became Miriam, Miriam of Majel. And Majel is spelled here, M-I-J-D-E-L. And probably that is Magdala in its short form. So, obviously, Kahlil Gibran believed the scriptures in a different way than we now understand Mary Magdalene as having been an initiate and not the harlot. Yet still in this writing, it's a beautiful sharing of the mysticism of the relationship. Maybe the first time he saw her or she saw him. Although, very likely they knew each other much before that, even as children before teens. So there are actually two other sharings by Mary Magdalene in this book, Jesus the Son of Man. I'd like to read them. His mouth was like the heart of a pomegranate, and the shadows in his eyes were deep. And he was gentle, like a man mindful of his own strength. In my dreams, I beheld the kings of the earth standing in awe in his presence. I would speak of his face, but how shall I? It was like night without darkness and like day without the noise of day. It was a sad face, and it was a joyous face. And well, I remember how once he raised his hand toward the sky, and his parted fingers were like the branches of an elm. And I remember him pacing the evening. He was not walking. He himself was a road above the road, even as a cloud above the earth that would descend to refresh the earth. And when I stood before him and spoke to him, he was a man, and his face was powerful to behold. And he said to me, what would you, Miriam? And I did not answer him, but my wings enfolded my secret, and I was made warm. Because I could bear his light no more, I turned and walked away, but not in shame. I was only shy. I would be alone with his fingers upon the strings of my heart. And then Mary Magdalene, 33 years later, once again I say that with death Jesus conquered death and rose from the grave a spirit and a power. And he walked in our solitude and visited the gardens of our passion. He lies not there in that cleft rock behind the stone. We who love him beheld him with these our eyes, which he made to see, and we touched him with these our hands, which he taught to reach forth. I know you who believe not in him. I was one of you, and you are many, but your number shall be diminished. Must you break your harp and your lyre to find the music therein? Or must you fell a tree ere you can believe it bears fruit? You hate Jesus because someone from the north country said he was the Son of God. But you hate one another because each of you deems himself too great to be the brother of the next man. You hate him because someone said he was born of a virgin and not of man's seed. But you know not the mothers who go to the tomb of virginity, nor the men who go down to the grave choked with their own thirst. You know not that the earth was given in marriage to the sun, and that earth it is who sends us forth to the mountain and the desert. There is a gulf that yawns between those who love him and those who hate him, between those who believe and those who do not believe. But when the years have bridged that gulf, you shall know that he who lived in us is deathless, that he was the Son of God, even as we are the children of God, that he was born of a virgin, even as we are born of the husbandless earth. It is passing strange that the earth gives not to the unbelievers the roots that would suck at her breast, nor the wings wherewith to fly high and drink, and be filled with the dews of her space. But I know what I know, and it is enough.